Chapter 2 of Celebrated Crimes, Volume 3 by Alexandre Dumas, translated by George Burnham Ives. Chapter 2. Among the lords who had followed Mary Stuart to Scotland was, as we have mentioned, a young nobleman named Chatelard, a true type of the nobility of that time, a nephew of Bayard on his mother's side, a poet and a knight, a talented and courageous, and attached to Marshal Damville, of whose household he formed one. Thanks to this high position, Chatelard, throughout her stay in France, paid court to Mary Stuart, who, in the homage he rendered her in verse, saw nothing more than those poetical declarations of gallantry customary in that age, and with which she especially was daily overwhelmed. But it happened that about the time when Chatelard was most in love with the queen, she was obliged to leave France, as we have said. Then Marshal Damville, who knew nothing of Chatelard's passion, and who himself, encouraged by Mary's kindness, was among the candidates to succeed Francis II as husband, set out for Scotland with the poor exile, taking Chatelard with him, and not imagining he would find a rival in him, he made a confidant of him, and left him with Mary when he was obliged to leave her, charging the young poet to support with her the interests of his suit. This post as confidant brought Mary and Chatelard more together, and, as in her capacity as poet, the queen treated him like a brother. He made bold in his passion to risk all to obtain another title. Accordingly, one evening he got into Mary Stuart's room and hid himself under the bed. But at the moment when the queen was beginning to undress, a little dog she had began to yelp so loudly that her women came running at his barking, and led by this indication, perceived Chatelard. A woman easily pardons a crime for which too great love is the excuse. Mary Stuart was a woman before being queen. She pardoned. But this kindness only increased Chatelard's confidence. He put down the reprimand he had received to the presence of the queen's women, and supposed that if she had been alone she would have forgiven him still more completely, so that 3 weeks after this same scene was repeated. But this time Chatelard, discovered in a cupboard, when the queen was already in bed, was placed under arrest. The moment was badly chosen. Such a scandal, just when the queen was about to remarry, was fatal to Mary, let alone to Chatelard. Murray took the affair in hand, and thinking that a public trial could alone save his sister's reputation, he urged the prosecution with such vigour that Chatelard, convicted of the crime of lèse majesté, was condemned to death. Mary entreated her brother that Chatelard might be sent back to France, but Murray made her see what terrible consequences such a use of her right of pardon might have, so that Mary was obliged to let justice take its course. Chatelard was led to the execution. Arrived on the scaffold, which was set up before the queen's palace, Chatelard, who had declined the services of a priest, had Ronsard's Ode on Death read, and when the reading, which he followed with evident pleasure, was ended, he turned towards the queen's windows, and having cried out for the last time, "Adieu, loveliest and most cruel of princesses!" he stretched out his neck to the executioner without displaying any repentance or uttering any complaint. This death made all the more impression upon Mary, that she did not dare to show her sympathy openly. Meanwhile, there was a rumour that the Queen of Scotland was consenting to a new marriage, and several suitors came forward, sprung from the principal reigning families of Europe. First, the Archduke Charles, third son of the Emperor of Germany, then the Duke of Anjou, who afterwards became Henry III. But to wed a foreign princess was to give up her claims to the English crown. So Mary refused, and making a merit of this to Elizabeth, she cast her eyes on a relation of the latter's, Henry Stuart, Lord Darnley, son of the Earl of Lennox. Elizabeth, who had nothing plausible to urge against this marriage, since the Queen of Scotland not only chose an Englishman for a husband, but was marrying into her own family, allowed the Earl of Lennox and his son to go to the Scotch court, reserving it to herself, if matters appeared to take a serious turn, to recall them both, a command which they would be constrained to obey, since all their property was in England. Darnley was 18 years of age. He was handsome, well-made, elegant. He talked in that attractive manner of the young nobles of the French and English courts that Mary no longer heard since her exile in Scotland. She let herself be deceived by these appearances, and did not see that under this brilliant exterior Darnley hid utter insignificance, a dubious courage, and a fickle and churlish character. It is true that he came to her under the auspices of a man whose influence was as striking as the risen fortune which gave him the opportunity to exert it. We refer to David Rizzio. David Rizzio, who played such a great part in the life of Mary Stuart, whose strange favour for him has given her enemies, probably without any cause, such cruel weapons against her, was the son of a Turin musician, burdened with a numerous family, who, recognizing in him a pronounced musical taste, had him instructed in the first principles of the art. At the age of 15, he had left his father's house and had gone on foot to Nice, where the Duke of Savoy held his court. There he entered the service of the Duke of Moreto, and this lord, having been appointed some years afterwards to the Scottish embassy, Rizzio followed him to Scotland. As this young man had a very fine voice, and accompanied on the viol and fiddle songs of which both the airs and the words were of his own composition, the ambassador spoke of him to Mary, who wished to see him. Rizzio, full of confidence in himself, and seeing in the queen's desire a road to success, hastened to obey her command, sang before her, and pleased her. She begged him then of Moreto, making no more of it than if she had asked of him a thoroughbred dog or a well-trained falcon. Moreto presented him to her, delighted at finding such an opportunity to pay his court, but scarcely was Rizzio in her service than Mary discovered that music was the least of his gifts, that he possessed, besides that, education, if not profound, at least varied, a supple mind, a lively imagination, gentle ways, and at the same time much boldness and presumption. He reminded her of those Italian artists whom she had seen at the French court, and spoke to her the tongue of Marot and Ronsard, whose most beautiful poems he knew by heart. This was more than enough to please Mary Stuart. In a short time he became her favorite, and meanwhile the place of secretary for the French dispatches falling vacant, Rizzio was provided for with it. Darnley, who wished to succeed at all costs, enlisted Rizzio in his interests, unconscious that he had no need of this support, and as, on her side, Mary, who had fallen in love with him at first sight, fearing some new intrigue of Elizabeth's, hastened on this union so far as the proprieties permitted, the affair moved forward with wonderful rapidity, and in the midst of public rejoicing, with the approbation of the nobility except for a small minority, with Murray at its head, the marriage was solemnized under the happiest auspices, 29th July, 1565. 2 days before, Darnley and his father, the Earl of Lennox, had received a command to return to London, and as they had not obeyed it, a week after the celebration of the marriage they learned that the Countess of Lennox, the only one of the family remaining in Elizabeth's power, had been arrested and taken to the Tower. Thus Elizabeth, in spite of her dissimulation, yielded to that first impulse of violence that she always had such trouble to overcome, publicly displayed her resentment. However, Elizabeth was not the woman to be satisfied with useless vengeance. She soon released the Countess, and turned her eyes towards Murray, the most discontented of the nobles in opposition, who by this marriage was losing all his personal influence. It was thus easy for Elizabeth to put arms in his hand. In fact, when he had failed in his first attempt to seize Darnley, he called to his aid the Duke of Châtellerault, Glencairn, Argyll, and Rothes, and collecting what partisans they could, they openly rebelled against the queen. This was the first ostensible act of that hatred which was afterwards so fatal to Mary. The queen, on her side, appealed to her nobles, who in response hastened to rally to her, so that in a month's time she found herself at the head of the finest army that ever a king of Scotland had raised. Darnley assumed the command of this magnificent assembly, mounted on a superb horse, arrayed in gilded armour, and accompanied by the queen, who, in riding habit, with pistols at her saddle-bow, wished to make the campaign with him, that she might not quit his side for a moment. Both were young, both were handsome, and they left Edinburgh amidst the cheers of the people and the army. Murray and his accomplices did not even try to stand against them, and the campaign consisted of such rapid and complex marches and countermarches that this rebellion is called the Runabout Raid, that is to say, the run in every sense of the word. Murray and the rebels withdrew to England, where Elizabeth, while seeming to condemn their unlucky attempt, afforded them all the assistance they needed. Mary returned to Edinburgh delighted at the success of her first two campaigns, not suspecting that this new good fortune was the last she would have, and that there her short-lived prosperity would cease. Indeed, she soon saw that in Darnley she had given herself not a devoted and very attentive husband, as she had believed, but an imperious and brutal master, who no longer having any motive for concealment, showed himself to her just as he was, a man of disgraceful vices, of which drunkenness and debauchery was the least. Accordingly, serious differences were not long in springing up in this royal household. Darnley, in wedding Mary, had not become king, but merely the queen's husband. To confer on him authority, nearly equaling a regent, it was necessary that Mary should grant him what was termed the crown matrimonial, a crown Francis II had worn during his short royalty, and that Mary, after Darnley's conduct to herself, had not the slightest intention of bestowing on him. Thus, to whatever entreaties he made, in whatever form they were wrapped, Mary merely replied with an unvaried and obstinate refusal. Darnley, amazed at this force of will in a young queen who had loved him enough to raise him to her, and not believing that she could find it in herself, sought in her entourage for some secret and influential adviser who might have inspired her with it. His suspicions fell on Rizzio, In reality, to whatever cause Rizzio owed his power, and to even the most clear-sighted historians this point has always remained obscure, be it that he ruled as lover, be it that he advised as minister, his counsels as long as he lived were always given for the greater glory of the queen. Sprung from so low, he at least wished to show himself worthy of having risen so high, and owing everything to Mary, he tried to repay her with devotion. Thus Darnley was not mistaken, and it was indeed Rizzio who, in despair at having helped to bring about a union which he foresaw must become so unfortunate, gave Mary the advice not to give up any of her power to one who already possessed much more than he deserved in possessing her person. Darnley, like all persons of both weak and violent character, disbelieved in the persistence of will in others, unless this will was sustained by an outside influence. He thought that in ridding himself of Rizzio, he could not fail to gain the day, since, as he believed, he alone was opposing the grant of this great desire of his, the crown matrimonial. Consequently, as Rizzio was disliked by the nobles in proportion as his merits had raised him above them, it was easy for Darnley to organize a conspiracy, and James Douglas of Morton, Chancellor of the Kingdom, consented to act as chief. This is the second time since the beginning of our narrative that we inscribe this name Douglas, so often pronounced in Scottish history, and which at this time, extinct in the elder branch known as the Black Douglases, was perpetuated in the younger branch known as the Red Douglases. It was an ancient, noble, and powerful family, which, when the descent in the male line from Robert Bruce had lapsed, disputed the royal title with the first Stuart, and which since then had constantly kept alongside the throne, sometimes its support, sometimes its enemy, envying every great house, for greatness made it uneasy, but above all, envious of the House of Hamilton, which, if not its equal, was at any rate, after itself, the next most powerful. During the whole reign of James V, thanks to the hatred which the king bore them, the Douglases had not only lost all their influence, but had also been exiled to England. This hatred was on account of their having seized the guardianship of the young prince and kept him prisoner till he was 15. Then, with the help of one of his pages, James V had escaped from Falkland, and had reached Stirling, whose governor was in his interests. Scarcely was he safe in the castle than he made proclamation that any Douglas who should approach within a dozen miles of it would be prosecuted for high treason. This was not all. He obtained a decree from Parliament, declaring them guilty of felony, and condemning them to exile. They remained proscribed then during the king's lifetime, and returned to Scotland only upon his death. The result was that, although they had been recalled about the throne, and though, thanks to the past influence of Murray, who won members, was a Douglas on the mother's side, they filled the most important posts there. They had not forgiven to the daughter the enmity borne them by the father. This was why James Douglas, chancellor as he was, and consequently entrusted with the execution of the laws, put himself at the head of a conspiracy which had for its aim the violation of all laws, human and divine. Douglas's first idea had been to treat Rizzio as the favourites of James III had been treated at the Bridge of Lauder, that is to say, to make a show of having a trial and to hang him afterwards. But such a death did not suffice for Darnley's vengeance, as above everything he wished to punish the queen in Rizzio's person, he exacted that the murder should take place in her presence. Douglas associated with himself Lord Ruthven, an idle and dissolute sybarite who, under the circumstances, promised to push his devotion so far as to wear a cuirass. Then, sure of this important accomplice, he busied himself with finding other agents. However, the plot was not woven with such secrecy but that something of it transpired, and Rizzio received several warnings that he despised. Sir James Melville, among others, tried every means to make him understand the perils a stranger ran who enjoyed such absolute confidence in a wild, jealous court like that of Scotland. Rizzio received these hints as if resolved not to apply them to himself, and Sir James Melville, satisfied that he had done enough to ease his conscience, did not insist further. Then a French priest, who had a reputation as a clever astrologer, got himself admitted to Rizzio, and warned him that the stars predicted that he was in deadly peril, and that he should beware of a certain bastard above all. Rizzio replied that from the day when he had been honoured with his sovereign's confidence, he had sacrificed in advance his life to his position, that since that time, however, he had had occasion to notice that in general the Scotch were ready to threaten but slow to act, that as to the bastard referred to, who was doubtless the Earl of Murray, he would take care that he should never enter Scotland far enough for his sword to reach him, were it as long as the Dumfries to Edinburgh, which in other words was as much as to say that Murray should remain exiled in England for life, since Dumfries was one of the principal frontier towns. Meanwhile, the conspiracy proceeded, and Douglas and Ruthven, having collected their accomplices and taken their measures, came to Darnley to finish the compact. As the price of the bloody service they rendered the king, they exacted from him a promise to obtain the pardon of Murray and the nobles compromised with him in the affair of the run in every sense. Darnley granted all they asked of him, and a messenger was sent to Murray to inform him of the expedition in preparation, and to invite him to hold himself in readiness to re-enter Scotland at the first notice he should receive. Then, this point settled, they made Darnley sign a paper in which he acknowledged himself the author and chief of the enterprise. The other assassins were the Earl of Morton, the Earl of Ruthven, George Douglas, the Bastard of Angus, Lidley, and Andrew Carew. The remainder were soldiers, simply murderers' tools, who did not even know what was afoot. Darnley reserved it for himself to appoint the time. 2 days after these conditions were agreed upon, Darnley, having been notified that the queen was alone with Rizzio, wished to make himself sure of the degree of her favour enjoyed by the minister. He accordingly went to her apartment by a little door of which he always kept the key upon him, but though the key turned in the lock, the door did not open. Then Darnley knocked, announcing himself, but such was the contempt into which he had fallen with the queen that Mary left him outside, although, supposing she had been alone with Rizzio, she would have had time to send him away. Darnley, driven to extremities by this, summoned Morton, Ruthven, Lennox, Lindley, and Douglas's bastard, and fixed the assassination of Rizzio for 2 days later. They had just completed all the details and had distributed the parts that each must play in this bloody tragedy, when suddenly, and at the moment when they least expected it, the door opened and Mary Stuart appeared on the threshold.
"My lords," said she, "your holding these secret councils is useless. I am informed of your plots, and with God's help I shall soon apply a remedy."
With these words, and before the conspirators had time to collect themselves, she shut the door again, and vanished like a passing but threatening vision. All remained thunderstruck. Morton was the first to find his tongue.
"My lords," said he, "this is a game of life and death, and the winner will not be the cleverest or the strongest, but the readiest. If we do not destroy this man, we are lost. We must strike him down this very evening, not the day after tomorrow."
Everyone applauded, even Ruthven, who, still pale and feverish from the riotous living, promised not to be behindhand. The only point changed, on Morton's suggestion, was that the murder should take place next day, for in the opinion of all, not less than a day's interval was needed to collect the minor conspirators, who numbered not less than 500. The next day, which was Saturday, March 9th, 1566, Mary Stuart, who had inherited from her father, James V, a dislike of ceremony and the need of liberty, had invited to supper with her 6 persons, Rizzio among the number. Darnley, informed of this in the morning, immediately gave notice of it to the conspirators, telling them that he himself would let them into the palace between 6 and 7 o'clock in the evening. The conspirators replied that they would be in readiness. The morning had been dark and stormy, as nearly all the first days of spring are in Scotland, and towards evening the snow and wind redoubled in depth and violence. So Mary had remained shut up with Rizzio, and Darnley, who had gone to the secret door several times, could hear the sound of instruments and the voice of the favourite, who was singing those sweet melodies which have come down to our time, and which Edinburgh people still attribute to him. These songs were for Mary a reminder of her stay in France, where the artists in the train of the Medicis had already brought echoes from Italy, but for Darnley they were an insult, and each time he had withdrawn strengthened in his design. At the appointed time, the conspirators, who had been given the password during the day, knocked at the palace gate, and were received there so much the more easily than Darnley himself, wrapped in a great cloak, awaited them at the postern by which they were admitted. The 500 soldiers immediately stole into an inner courtyard, where they placed themselves under some sheds, as much to keep themselves from the cold as that they might not be seen on the snow-covered ground. A brightly lighted window looked into this courtyard. It was that of the queen's study. At the first signal given them from this window, the soldiers were to break in the door and go to the help of the chief conspirators. These instructions given, Darnley led Morton, Ruthven, Lennox, Lindley, Andrew Carew, and Douglas's bastard into the room adjoining the study, and only separated from it by a tapestry hanging before the door. From there one could overhear all that was being said, and at a single bound fall upon the guests. Darnley left them in this room, enjoying silence. Then, giving them as a signal to enter the moment when they should hear him cry, "To me, Douglas!" he went round by the secret passage, so that seeing him come in by his usual door, the queen's suspicions might not be roused by his unlooked-for visit. Mary was at supper with six persons, having Cedatou and Melville, Rizzio seated on her right, while, on the contrary, Carapden assures us that he was eating standing at a sideboard. The talk was gay and intimate, for all were giving themselves up to the ease one feels at being safe and warm, at a hospitable board, while the snow is beating against the windows and the wind roaring in the chimneys. Suddenly Mary's surprise that the most profound silence had succeeded to the lively and animated flow of words among her guests since the beginning of supper, and suspecting from their glances that the cause of their uneasiness was behind her, turned round and saw Darnley leaning on the back of her chair. The queen shuddered, for although her husband was smiling when looking at Rizzio, this smile led assumed such a strange expression that it was clear that something terrible was about to happen. At the same moment Mary heard in the next room a heavy, dragging step drew near to the cabinet. Then the tapestry was raised, and Lord Ruthven, in armor of which he could barely support the weight, pale as a ghost, appeared on the threshold, and drawing his sword in silence, leaned upon it. The queen thought he was delirious.
"What do you want, my lord?" she said to him. "And why do you come to the palace like this?"
"Ask the king, madam," replied Ruthven in an indistinct voice. "It is for him to answer."
"Explain, my lord," demanded Mary, turning again towards Darnley. "What does such a neglect of ordinary propriety mean?"
"It means, madam," returned Darnley, pointing to Rizzio, "that that man must leave here this very minute."
"That man is mine, my lord," Mary said, rising proudly, "and consequently takes orders only from me."
"To me, Douglas!" cried Darnley.
At these words, the conspirators, who for some moments had drawn near Ruthven, fearing so changeable was Darnley's character lest he had brought them in vain, and would not dare to utter the signal at these words, the conspirators rushed into the room with such haste that they overturned the table. Then David Rizzio, seeing that it was they alone wanted, threw himself on his knees behind the queen, seizing the hem of her robe and crying in Italian, "Giustizia, giustizia!" Indeed, the queen, true to her character, not allowing herself to be intimidated by this terrible eruption, placed herself in front of Rizzio and sheltered him behind her majesty. But she counted too much on the respect of a nobility accustomed to struggle hand to hand with its kings for 5 centuries. Andrew Carew held a dagger to her breast and threatened to kill her if she insisted on defending any longer him whose death was resolved upon. Then Darnley, without consideration for the queen's pregnancy, seized her round the waist and bore her away from Rizzio, who remained on his knees, pale and trembling, while Douglas's bastard, confirming the prediction of the astrologer who had warned Rizzio to beware of a certain bastard, drawing the king's own dagger, plunged it into the breast of the minister, who fell wounded but not dead. Morton immediately took him by the feet and dragged him from the cabinet into the larger room, leaving on the floor that long track of blood which is still shown there. Then, arrived there, each rushed upon him as upon a quarry, and set upon the corpse, which they stabbed in 56 places. Meanwhile, Darnley held the queen, who, thinking that all was not over, did not cease crying for mercy. But Ruthven came back, paler than at first, and at Darnley's inquiry if Rizzio were dead, he nodded in the affirmative. Then, as he could not bear further fatigue in his convalescent state, he sat down, although the queen, whom Darnley had at last released, remained standing on the same spot. At this, Mary could not contain herself.
"My lord," cried she, "who has given you permission to sit down in my presence, and whence comes such insolence?"
"Madam," Ruthven answered, "I act thus not from insolence, but from weakness, for to serve your husband I have just taken more exercise than my doctors allow."
Then turning round to a servant,
"Give me a glass of wine,"
said he, showing Darnley his bloody dagger before putting it back in its sheath,
"for here is the proof that I have well earned it."
The servant obeyed, and Ruthven drained his glass with as much calmness as if he had just performed the most innocent act.
"My lord," the queen then said, taking a step towards him, "it may be that, as I am a woman, in spite of my desire and my will, I never find an opportunity to repay you what you are doing to me, but," she added energetically, striking her womb with her hand, "he whom I bear there, and whose life you should have respected, since you respect my majesty so little, will one day revenge me for all these insults."
Then, with a gesture at once superb and threatening, she withdrew by Darnley's door, which she closed behind her. At that moment a great noise was heard in the queen's room. Huntley, Athol, and Bothwell, who, we are soon about to see, play such an important part in the sequel of this history, were supping together in another hall of the palace, when suddenly they had heard outcries and the clash of arms, so that they had run with all speed. When Athol, who came first without knowing whose it was, struck against the dead body of Rizzio, which was stretched at the top of the staircase, they believed, seeing someone assassinated, that the lives of the king and queen were threatened, and they had drawn their swords to force the door that Morton was guarding. But directly Darnley understood what was going on. He darted from the cabinet, followed by Ruthven, and showing himself to the newcomers.
"My lords," he said, "the persons of the queen and myself are safe, and nothing has occurred here but by our orders. Withdraw, then. You will know more about it in time. As to him," he added, holding up Rizzio's head by the hair,
whilst the bastard of Douglas lit up the face with a torch so that it could be recognized,
"you see who it is, and whether it is worth your while to get into trouble for him."
And in fact, as soon as Huntly, Athol, and Bothwell had recognized the musician minister, they sheathed their swords, and having saluted the king, went away. Mary had gone away with a single thought in her heart: vengeance. But she understood that she could not revenge herself at one and the same time on her husband and his companions. She set to work, then, with all the charms of her wit and beauty, to detach the kind from his accomplices. It was not a difficult task. When that brutal rage which so often carried Darnley beyond all bounds was spent, he was frightened himself at the crime he had committed, and while the assassins, assembled by Murray, were resolving that he should have the greatly desired crown matrimonial, Darnley, as fickle as he was violent, and as cowardly as he was cruel, in Mary's very room, before the scarcely dried blood, made another compact, in which he engaged to deliver up his accomplices. Indeed, 3 days after the event that we have just related, the murderers learned a strange piece of news, that Darnley and Mary, accompanied by Lord Satan, had escaped together from Holyrood Palace. 3 days later still, a proclamation appeared, signed by Mary and dated from Dunbar, which summoned round the queen in her own name and the king's all the Scottish lords and barons, including those who had been compromised in the affair of the run in every sense, to whom she not only granted full and complete pardon, but also restored her entire confidence. In this way, she separated Murray's cause from that of Morton and the other assassins, who in their turn, seeing that there was no longer any safety for them in Scotland, fled to England, where all the queen's enemies were always certain to find a warm welcome, in spite of the good relations which reigned in appearance between Mary and Elizabeth. As to Bothwell, who had wanted to oppose the assassination, he was appointed warden of all the marches of the kingdom. Unfortunately for her honour, Mary, always more the woman than the queen, while, on the contrary, Elizabeth was always more the queen than the woman, had no sooner regained her power than her first royal act was to exhume Rizzio, who had been quietly buried on the threshold of the chapel nearest Holyrood Palace, and to have him removed to the burial place of the Scottish kings, compromising herself still more by the honour she paid him dead than by the favour she had granted him living. Such an imprudent demonstration naturally led to fresh quarrels between Mary and Darnley. These quarrels were the more bitter that, as one can well understand, the reconciliation between the husband and wife, at least on the latter's side, had never been anything but a pretense, so that, feeling herself in a stronger position still on account of her pregnancy, she restrained herself no longer, and leaving Darnley, she went from Dunbar to Edinburgh Castle, where on June 19, 1566, 3 months after the assassination of Rizzio, she gave birth to a son who afterwards became James VI. End of chapter 2.